ओके प्रियंका मैम, सो शैल बी स्टार्ट नाउ? सर शैल बी स्टार्ट नाउ?
यस मैम, यस मैम, श्योर।
सो वंस अगेन वेलकम टू द
सर शैल बी स्टार्ट नाउ?
यस यस आई एम रेडी। यस
सो आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट आवर टुडेज स्पीकर टू द डे 3 ऑफ AICTE स्पॉन्सर्ड ऑनलाइन शॉर्ट टर्म ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम ऑन द टॉपिक इंटरप्ले बिटवीन हेल्थ वेलबींग एनवायरमेंट एंड कम्युनिटी फार्मेसी। सो बिफोर मूविंग अहेड आई वुड लाइक टू इंट्रोड्यूस अवर टुडेज स्पीकर विद द ऑडियंस। Respected Dr. Umesh Gupta sir, currently sir is working as an assistant professor at Department of Pharmacy, Central University of Rajasthan, Ajmer, India. Sir did his PhD in Pharmaceutical Sciences from Dr. H.S. Gore Central University, India, under the mentorship of respected Professor N.K. Jain sir. He has recently awarded AAIPS Distinguished Young Educator and Researcher Award 2019. To attend annual conference of AAPS 2019 Pharmacy 360 at San Antonio, Texas, USA. He is also recipient of First Chancellor Award for Best Faculty 2018 at Central University of Rajasthan, Ajmer, India. He has also awarded DAAD Research Stays for Academics and Scientists 2017 at Leibniz Institute for Polymer Forschung, Dresden, Germany. He has a past experience of a research scientist at Ranbaxy Research Laboratories, India, and postdoctoral research associate at South Dakota State University, USA. He has more than 10 years of research and academic experience. The area of research is mainly focused on dendrimer-mediated drug delivery, solubilization, and targeting. He has more than 71 publications, 3 edited books, 17 book chapters, and 1 patent published to his credit with total citation of more than 4,425. H index of 30 as per Scopus and 32 as per Google Scholar. So with a such vast great achievement, with that note, I would like to invite respected sir to address our audience with his lecture. Welcome sir, welcome once again.
Thank you Surbhi ma'am. Thank you for the brief introduction and thank you once again for inviting me. A very good afternoon to all those who are participating in this session. I am extremely thankful for the Sagar Institute of Research in Technology Pharmacy for inviting me as one of the speaker in this FDP program. I am especially thankful to Dr. Surendra Jain sir, the convener of the program, Engineer Sanjeev Agrawal sir, the CMT of SAGIC Group, Ms. Shivani Agrawal, ma'am, Executive Director of SAGIC Group, Surbhi Madam and Priyanka Rathor Madam, who are looking after as organizing secretary and coordinator for this particular program. Extremely thankful and thank you for giving me this opportunity. And in the next, you know, couple of minutes, I am going to engage you basically in two kind of discussions. I will call it as a discussion because I'll just be in a mode of making you understand the importance of newer, the drug delivery technologies, which are actually under research or which you might all know a little bit in an introductory manner. But at the same time, I will also take your attention on artificial intelligence. Though we are now surrounded with so many gadgets today, which actually work based on artificial intelligence only, but how they are actually helping us in medicines also. So let me first share my slides and so that you can get a better outlook of what I'm going to discuss. So I'm sure that you are able to see my slides. Is it perfectly?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'm Umesh, like working as assistant professor, as Surbhi ma'am already introduced me, in Central University of Rajasthan. My core area of research is mainly drug delivery, of course, targeting, working on dendrimers, the nanoparticulate drug delivery system. But in the recent years, I realized that now we have a better tools actually to diagnose or even to treat, or even to extrapolate the existing outcome of our analytical studies, either maybe it you might visualize or you may be getting it in terms of QVD kind of software, in which we are actually able to reduce the overall number of experimentation which we have to perform. Now, today's lecture, as I already told you, that it is actually divided into two parts, or I should say in two sections, starting from what is nano and how nano is actually impacting in our medicinal, approaches, and how it is becoming, day by day important. Now, many of us understand nano means the nanometric size. Of course, it is related to the nanometric size. And if you remember, I'm taking some examples to make you better understand how the world day by day is getting smaller in terms of technology. I'm using the word smaller because if you go back just say 10 year back or 15 year back time, you remember everywhere the micro world was very much popular. We had micro spheres in drug delivery. Some companies also established like Microtech, we know now. Even Microsoft is a word starting from micro. Now, what I want to tell you, I remember a lecture from my mentor, supervisor N.K. Jain sir, in one of the sessions when we were attending him, that he visualized that day by day, the world of technology is getting smaller. He told us that when we were students, there was a very much culture of working on millimeter scale. Then the research shifted to micro level. We know microsphere, micro technology, microfibers, these terms were very popular. And then we are now shifting to nanotechnology, which is, of course, 1 × 10⁻⁹, the size which I'm talking about. And he very cleverly placed a slide in his discussion that was related to Ramayana, Mahabharata, and then he actually told us, he delivered that in mythology, you might have heard about Rakshasas whose size was too huge. Day by day, the size got reduced. We human being in comparison to some, mythological creature are very small. So it is a culture of getting smaller with a better cognizance, with a better mindset, with a better knowledge, analytical skill. And that's how he visualized that now we are living in the world of nanotechnology. Maybe after 20 years, we may visualize a era which will be picotechnology, which will come or which will actually focus on picotechnology. So those who are in the age of 20s or 25 year of age, they might remember that micro was a very focused word. Micro technology was very much popular just 15 year back. Now it is an era of nanotechnology, and in future we may visualize a technology era which we call pico technology. Now what is nano? I just want to make you assure or make you feel that nanoscience, it is the study of objects measured in nanometers, of course. And this is the photograph which I have shown in this slide, is a photograph of a hair, okay? And width of this line is in general visualized to be 100 nanometer. And this is the part of one hair, which I'm telling to you. And the hair, the line, line represents 100 nanometer, but the hair is actually the 100 nanometer size is actually 80,000 times lesser than the width of actual hair. And that's how the importance of small creatures exist. Now, why this nanoscale? Now, you have to, if you talk about drug delivery, in such a smaller and tiny scale structure, you have to encapsulate the drug molecule as well. So the technology is not simple, that I want to tell you, but it has been inspired from the nature. That is very important. So you know GECO system, right? GECOs are natural creatures. and they have a tendency, they can walk on wall, you know, without any problem. Now, when you see that their adhesive system, how they walk on wall, it comes into a very fine beta structures, which we can see that they are in thousand number, or you can say the feet pads of Gecko are having such a tiny single setas, which actually have very smaller size, and that's how it creates a grip and they can walk. Now, inspired from these, if you see the adhesive technology, which actually imbibed this technology or this natural concept of adhesiveness, if you go through the very high adhesive materials or super adhesive materials, they are utilizing this kind of technology in which the micro the size of the materials which are going to be used for adhesive purpose, they have this tendency like Gecko used to follow. And these synthetic nanomaterials have strong adhesion properties because they have a nanometric size assemblies which actually take part in adhesion. Now, this is something which just I'm taking an example how nano is actually intervening in the other, you know, in the other areas. Now, when I come to nanomedicine, right? So it does involve chemistry, it does involve biology, it does involve nanotechnology together. And that's how we come up with the term nanomedicine, which all of us might have definitely heard of. Now, I'll take one example to make you understand. So what if the size is less? What is the problem with a 25 paise or 1 rupees paracetamol tablet? Unnecessarily, people are indulging in making nanoparticle. So first of all, I want to make you clear that every drug is not a good candidate to be developed in the form of nanoparticle or nanomedicine-based carrier. Rather, there are certain properties which actually makes it a suitable candidate for, you know, to be developed in the form of nanoparticle. So let us take one very good example, how it is helpful, the nanomedicine is helpful in treating certain disorders. Now, if you see tumor, all of us know we have a different understanding of tumor. We know it can be malignant, it can be benign. If it is malignant, it can travel from one area of the body to other through blood vessels, through, you know, circulation, and it is more dangerous. But what is tumor? Tumor is nothing but we say it is an uncontrolled growth of cell. I always tell my molecular biology student that DNA is something which is a miraculous molecule. Why it is miraculous? Because it doesn't have only the power of division, but it has the power of differentiation. So how we can understand the power of differentiation is one example, very good example, that when a skin surface get removed because of some wound or some injury, it doesn't get replaced by liver. It doesn't get replaced by eye. Aapko koi chot lagti hai agar skin pe, to wahan pe ear nahi aa jata hai replacement mein. Replacement mein skin hi aati hai. Agar आपका नोज डैमेज हुआ है तो नोज की जगह पर नोज की ही टिश्यू आएगी. ये पावर कहां से आया? दिस इज द पावर ऑफ डिफरेंशिएशन दैट द मैसेज कोडेड इन द डीएनए. द डीएनए इज सेम इन ऑल द सेल्स ऑफ आवर बॉडी, बट द एरिया व्हिच दे एग्जिस्ट, वेयर दे एग्जिस्ट, दे हैव टू टेक अप दैट शेप. एंड द पावर ऑफ डिफरेंशिएशन मेक्स द डीएनए एज अ वेरी मिरेकुलस डिस्कवरी ऑफ 20th सेंचुरी. And why I always tell this, now come up to, so in tumor, what happens? In the tumor, the cells lose the message of differentiation. They lose the message that I have to replace some cells only and to stop. If some blood capillary got damaged, I have to replace it with blood capillary. So that message is missed. And somehow that metabolic changes leads to uncontrolled growth. So cells are growing, body is trying to supply the blood, hypoxia starts, and it leads to lesser supply of oxygen. and immature development of blood vessel. Everywhere in the body, whenever uncontrolled cell growth or any kind of cell growth takes place, body have a tendency to supply the blood there. When the blood will be supplied, obviously the oxygen will be supplied for the proper growth of the cells. So when there is an uncontrolled growth, okay, the blood vessels generates, which we call angiogenesis, and these blood vessels tries to supply the blood in this cell mass also, which is growing in an uncontrolled manner. But the blood vessels or the capillaries doesn't get mature enough, and the cell layer again cover them up and keeping them as immature blood vessels. Now, what happens with immature blood vessels is that their endothelium is not packed enough, so that whatever blood is passing through them, it will have a leaky nature, or their walls remain so thin because of uncontrolled growth of cells over them that their vasculature or their walls remain leaky. Now, why I'm telling all this story about tumor is that here comes the role of size. So whenever I have given an anti-cancer drug in the nanoparticle, it is injected in the blood, it is flowing all part, liver, heart, everywhere in the body. But whenever it will pass through the tumorous area, because the blood vessels are so much leaky because of the uncontrolled growth and immature growth of blood vessels, because of the size of nanoparticle and leaky nature of the blood vessels, that nanoparticle will come out. And whenever it will come out, it is actually in the area of tumor. It will come out in which cells? Which are tumorous cell, uncontrolled cells. And this is the phenomena which we call enhanced permeation and retention effect. Or indirectly, you can simply say it is a passive targeting. What we have targeted, by the way, we have targeted tumor directly without any ligand, just by reducing the size. And because the size was so less that it can cross the blood vessels membrane, or you can say a leaky vasculature. Vasculature can be a literature term. Simply say that leaky blood vessels or leaky blood capillaries. And that's how nanoparticle will come out in an area with the drug, which is tumor. And we will say tumor got targeted. This is just one example of understanding a tumor, a solid tumor physiology, and how EPR or enhanced permeation and retention effect does have an importance, so that it can be targeted directly to the tumorous area, leaving all the other body organs unaffected or having lesser exposure of nanoparticles. Now, this is one way of telling why nano size is important. There are other ways of ligand targeting that I'm not going to discuss, because you might already know that. But I'm going to discuss how nanomedicine, came into existence. And nowadays, it is a huge share of market, or in fact, the research which is going on in nanomedicine is of huge research. It is of huge ratio. So in Tokyo Science University, Professor Nario in 1974 introduced the term nanomedicine. Then after the term was coined, actually, even that time also, and even now also, nanotechnology was coined. And since then, you will see that nanotechnology is actually having importance not only in medicine, but it is also having importance in other important field of life. Okay, but we will focus on nanomedicine. And then European Science Foundation defined the nanomedicine as the science and technology of diagnosing, treating, and preventing diseases and traumatic injuries, of relieving pain and improving human health using certain molecular tools. They did not define that time what are these molecular tools, but we now know that there are so many nanocarriers, nanomedicine tools, which are used in the nanomedicine. So day by day, as per this slide also, you can see that the market share is growing for nanomedicine at a rate of 28% to 35%. And a lot of companies have come forward for the investment in the nanomedicine. Now, you will see in the coming slides that we will talk about only introductory part of certain careers. That is also just a definition I will discuss. But you will come to know that there are so many nanomedicine careers nowadays, and they are going to replace in the coming 30 to 40 years the market maybe of conventional dosage form. Yes, we may feel like this, but yes, we can't say at this point, but the way it is growing, maybe in the future we will see a very good market share of nanomedicine based product. Now, I told you that some of the examples that because of localized delivery, targeted delivery, these are the big terms which are used with the nanomedicine. I just gave you one example of EPR, which is helpful in tumor. So is the case with other disease physiology also, which can be modulated, which can be tailor-made with the nanomedicine carriers, and that can be utilized for targeting of different diseases. Now, these are certain tools which you already know. I'm not going to discuss these much, but liposomes, nanoparticles, solid lipid nanoparticles, the liposomes of multilayer vesicle. Okay, these are certain nanocares. The two liposomes shown in the slide, the one is actually SUV, small unilamellar vesicle, and the another one is multilamellar vesicle, having more layers of phospholipid and, you know, the other other polymers. So every carrier which you know now in nanomedicine have its own importance of delivering drug, loading drug, whatever you say. Now, my area of research, which I do work mainly on dendrimers, and I have worked on dendrimers for almost 10 to 15 years, but nanoparticles, liposomes, multilamellar vesicles are equally important carrier systems, which have now proved to be in the market. I'm not taking example of BioLakes or Embiosome, which are liposomal formulations, or so many others, which are nanomedicines, which are now in the market, which are based on nanocarriers, either nanoparticles or, you know, liposomes maybe. So what does nanocarriers do, right? So I already told you the size matters, and the nanoparticles have different properties, or nanocarriers, which we know now, like liposome, polymeric micelle, dendrimers, quantum dots, CNTs, mesoporous silica nanoparticles. These are certain names of the dosage forms or novel dosage forms, novel drug delivery systems, which you know, which we study. So they have different properties. We can't generalize them. But the one thing we generalize them is that they have a smaller size. Size is also not always less than 100 nanometer. In a broad sense, if you will see, this size ranges up to 300 to 400 nanometer as well, which can be considered as a standard size for different nanocarriers to be utilized in drug delivery. Now, what is the tendency of these nanocarriers? They have a tendency that they can be utilized for making the drug encapsulated to be stabilized. They have a tendency that whenever they are used, they can have enhanced absorption. Okay, enhanced absorption in terms of bioavailability I'm talking about. And they have a tendency to control over the distribution also. Okay, and they can be designed or they can be tailor-made for stealth property. Now, stealth nature is something which is, when you make a nanocarrier to circulate in our blood for an enhanced period of time. So even now I see that some of the students in my class, when they come for the first time to understand controlled and sustained drug delivery, it is different from targeted drug delivery. And when I ask them, what do you mean by controlled drug delivery, or what do you mean by sustained drug delivery? And when I say controlled, definitely something is controlled. There is something which is going to be controlled. Now, what to be controlled? If you read out a very good book of Banker and Rhodes for modern pharmaceutics, you will see that they have written a very good definition that the control in two sense can be considered for controlled drug delivery. They say that temporal control and spatial control. What do you mean by temporal control? Temporal is the time control. Spatial control is a site control where we want to deliver. So controlled drug delivery is that in which a carrier system is actually designed in such a way that we can decide when it will release the drug. That is a temporal control. We will decide, our formulation will decide as a formulator that where the drug should be released. That is a spatial control. And that's how we say that controlled drug delivery can be defined. So if I say enteric-coated tablet, we know that it will not get released, it will not release the drug before 2 hours of time, unless it crosses the stomach. It will only release the drug in the intestine. We have controlled it. We want that it should not be released in the stomach. I'm sure you all know the enteric-coated formulation. I'm not going into that. Phthalate polymers, CAP, right? Cellulose acetate, phthalate. So many other cellulose-based polymers are also there. So controlling. Now, what is sustained release? Sustained is extending, prolonged release, right? So delayed release tablet, right? Extended release tablet. These are considered to be sustained release. Sustained for what? Sustained for certain period, maybe up to a week. And that are, we call it as sustained release. But the targeted is something we are only focusing on one particular area. So controlled, sustained targeting. You all know, just I wanted to rebrush that in this discussion so that we will be on the same page. Now, this was all about basics of, you know, nanomedicine, which I wanted to make you aware. And then we will come to the topic which I have taken, that the artificial intelligence. But before just going into a quick, you know, discussion of what are the applications, I'm telling you, in case of nanomedicine, more than therapeutic application, I'm telling you the diagnostic applications are all equally important. In fact, more than drug delivery, you will see the applicability of nanomedicine in diagnosis. But if you talk about therapeutic application, I told you the site-specific or targeted drug delivery. The one emerging area, which is gene delivery, DNA, RNA, siRNA, miRNA, snoRNA, all kind of this RNAi technology is also based on certain vectors, non-viral vectors, okay? And if some of you are in the M-Pharm pharmaceutics or you must be teaching M-Pharm pharmaceutics, you will see that the first syllabus of MPH 201T, there is a section of non-viral vectors or gene delivery, I think the fourth unit, and you will see that the gene delivery is equally gaining momentum. We may expect in the future that there will not be any chemical molecule, but all the diseases may be treated by delivering DNA or a specific RNA. So gene delivery, again, gaining momentum. However, DNA, RNA cannot be delivered without vectors. And that's how the importance of viral vector and non-viral vectors. Then in non-viral vectors, you know, dendrimer is one, liposome is one, so many others. So just want to tell you that therapeutic applications are also too many. If you see the repair of damaged tissue, I'll tell you that in the burn, in the wound of burn wound, I would say, the nanofibers are taking very much important role. And we have now sheets of nanofibers, which when attached to the patient who is having burn wound, they get stick on the surface and they get dissolved without any touch. Treating burn patient is actually one of the difficult challenges the medical science deal with. Touching the surface of the patient, skin surface of the patient, is very dangerous for him or her. It is very painful. And so something which can be sprayed, something which can be just one time wrapped to the surface of the burn wound is highly, highly helpful. And nanofibers, you might have heard this word, is actually taking very good role in treating burn wound. So that's how the plethora of applications are there associated with nanomedicine. Now, very important. And I take this topic not only in terms of nanomedicine, but how the youth of today is actually, I would say, I will use the term trap of nanomedicine and trap of artificial intelligence. Why I will say trap of artificial intelligence? Because many, you know, students who are beginner in the college or even in the post graduation, they are very much fond of using social media. Every hour details, every 3 hour details, posting as a WhatsApp status. So if I am looking to somebody just by following his 15 days WhatsApp status, I may get an idea that where this person works, what is his or her hobbies in general, what he likes by seeing his or her post, Facebook post. It is always good to share your thoughts, photos, or whatever you want to share, videos and all, with all of your friends. But the tendency of accepting the friend request on Facebook or WhatsApp is not that much strict when you accept or just confirm any friend request. Now, unless you know the importance of the security measures, I always take this as a very risky business of social media, which is actually driving you. So one of my vice chancellor who was there in our university, Central University of Rajasthan, Professor Arun Kumar Pujari, one day I was listening to his lecture that how the artificial intelligence or the face recognition system has actually taken up the security of an individual, the banking system in which so much information which is there on social media can be taken up by anybody else. And you might have seen a very good documentary or a film on Netflix called Jamtara. Those kind of, you know, incidences are growing day by day. And you know, this artificial intelligence sometimes fools you, sometimes drive you. I'm using the word how it drives you. I'll give you one example, then we'll come back to this concept. So I have to go from Jaipur to, say, Mumbai, and I'm looking for an air ticket. When I was going to bed yesterday, I'm just taking an example, right? I have not done this yesterday, just I'm taking an example. So yesterday when I was going to bed, I just searched in Google, what is the air ticket price between Jaipur to Mumbai? And I saw some flights available in Make My Trip, maybe on airline website. I just went to bed. Okay, morning came, I woke up, all right, done. I have just opened my Facebook account. I have just opened Google, Gmail, whatever I want to read. Parallelly, you will see that the advertise will start coming to you through your laptop, that the price of the flight for Jaipur to Mumbai got down or got reduced. You can fly from Jaipur to Mumbai. How does internet know that I am planning to go from Jaipur to Mumbai? Because you have put your thought on the internet and the travel websites have taken up your account and they have started you flashing the advertisement parallelly for next 3-4 days till you book the ticket or till you do not interested or do not click on that advertisement. So same is applicable with the Amazon and Flipkart. You are searching for a shoe pair. You have searched one today. Next day you will see that automatically similar kind of shoes, it will start flashing on your Flipkart page, on your Amazon page. Now or then, after some time, whenever you will find a good deal, you will purchase. Actually, they have created a pressure on you to actually purchase it from our website only. And that's why I always say that artificial intelligence is driving you nowadays. So you were not really ready to purchase the shoes, but because the 3,000 shoes was given in an offer of 1,000 rupees, immediately you purchased it. Your old shoes was also working well. I mean, it could actually last long for next 1 year. But because it was given for 1,000 rupees and your pocket capacity was very much good to make expense of 1,000 rupees, and because Flipkart is your very good friend, he suggested that please purchase. It is a Reebok shoes. Generally, we sell it for 3,500. But for you, Umesh Gupta, I'm selling it for 900 rupees. Please purchase. You purchase it and Flipkart job is done. So this is one example I'm giving you. And then we will come again to the another example, which I want to tell you is the useful one, which is very useful. The useful AI example is the GPS system. You are going to MP Nagar Circle. You are going to Board Office Chauraha. You want to get an idea of the traffic. And you see the red line in the Google map. And you can bypass. You may take some other turn from Jinsi Circle, or you may take other turn from, you know, Habibganj area, okay, taking some other route to go to your destination. So one lecture when I listened to Pujari sir, and he was telling that how artificial intelligence is controlled by humans only. So one software engineer did an experiment. He took some 40 or 50 mobiles, kept its internet on, and he went putting all the mobiles together in a cart to a circle, to a very known circle in the city, which doesn't have any traffic. Now, somebody who is about to pass through that circle, when I checked in the GPS, it was showing very much high traffic, because that person was carrying 40 mobiles in that circle, though there was no traffic. But the other person who was looking to bypass or to pass through that circle, through GPS, was seeing that there is a very high, you know, traffic at that circle. So how humans actually can control artificial intelligence, that is very, very important to know. So it is something which is a technology. It should not become your behavior. That is very important to know. So artificial intelligence, some of the examples are, it is in general not well defined, but it is a capability of a machine to imitate the intelligent human behavior. So machines imitate our behavior. When you cross a circle according to GPS, which is wrong, immediately GPS will think that you have crossed the wrong circle. And now you take U-turn. It will keep on telling you, take the U-turn, take the U-turn. This is the helpful behavior of the artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence is the simulation of human intelligence, which is processed by machines, especially by computer systems. This we know. Now, can a machine think and behave like humans do? Yes, it can. But I'm telling you, humans will always control the machine. And I gave you an example of GPS experiment in which one person took 40 mobiles to a traffic circle, and that showed to be jammed by a person who want to visit or to cross that circle. But actually there was only one person standing at that circle of, you know, road, or, you know, on that particular intersection. So artificial intelligence is something created by humans, and we need to use this technology very judiciously and very importantly to understand that it should be helpful to you and it should not take something bad from you. So some of the very good example I gave, one, Google Maps. The majority of application which you see of AI today is in the gaming technology, one of the biggest sectors nowadays. And you see the technology that in the sports strategies, whenever there is an LBW, especially in cricket, you see that how the ball can actually hit the stump. That is a part of AI. Tesla is a company which is nowadays developing something which we call self-driving cars. It is AI. These are something which are very helpful technologies. I'm not a supporter of video games or PUBG kind of game, but the other three things, self-driving car, Google Maps, you know, predicting whether the the batsman is out or not is definitely helpful in a particular game. Now discussing like how AI techniques are helpful in healthcare. When we talk about AI technologies which are helpful in healthcare, we come across certain terms such as machine learning, deep learning, neural networks, support vector system, natural language processing. Now, these may be difficult terms to understand as a pharmacy student or teacher, but I'm telling you, these are different forms of the artificial systems or technologies which are being used in the healthcare. I'll take one by one about this, that what is machine learning, what is deep learning. So all in all, I want to tell you again that this is something that imagine that there is an accident. In fact, I'll take this example further. And some patients have gone through, one patient have gone through a broken backbone. Now, because it has existed vertebral columns, which are safe, which were safe in the accident, but somebody has to implant the newer, or you can say synthetic vertebrates after surgery, then what will be the exact shape of those vertebral columns to be implanted during surgery? That can be determined based on the existing shape of the vertebrates, which actually are safe. This is something which is based on extrapolation, which we always say that this is something which is based on artificial intelligence. So machine learning is one section or one type of artificial intelligence. And it says that it is the ability of a computer to learn from experience. That is to modify its processing on the basis of newly acquired information. The very good example, all of us know, some of you must be teaching as a teacher or some of you as a student must have heard of, especially the PG student, the QBD, right? Quality by design. Design of experiment is one name of the software, which is a part of QBD. And when we feed the information of the existing formulation which we have designed, it can give us the further information based on the feed information so that we can design a particular formulation, whether it is nanoparticle, whether it is tablet, whether it is multi-layer tablet, that an optimum tablet must be designed. So based on information, a machine learns and then it gives its interpretation. It gives you an idea that you should go in this direction. You should follow these steps or you should follow this particular equation as a particular case of DOE that this particular formulation should be designed. So this process can be, based on a simple decision making that we have done in the past, these kind of decisions, so that in the coming situation also, we should do this. So based on the existing knowledge. Now, when it comes to deep learning, okay, deep learning is actually more complex, more advanced type of artificial intelligence, which involves a human kind of thinking. It mimics the learning, which is similar to the human brain, right? And it takes the multiple data set, not only the simple data. For example, the machine learning cannot perform the complex functions of artificial intelligence, but deep learning or deep learning based systems can do. The robotic systems does involve deep learning. Okay, some part of it, you must be listening to certain robotic system which can do surgery, simple surgeries. And that's how the deep learning is getting involved in these systems. Now, when I say that deep learning is more complex than machine learning, even more complex term comes, which is called as neural network. Now you can imagine that I'm talking about first as a whole human being, then I'm talking about only brain, and now I came into neurons. It is something going like that. So at the neuronal level, if I'm doing something, it is obviously going to impact brain in a more advanced way. In a similar way, the software have neural network. And it is the extension of the complex linear as well as non-linear relationships between input variable and outcome. Now, this is something I'm telling you, this is a permutation combination which we get out of a particular AI machine. So what are the suggestions? That is what, so I'm not saying that GPS involves neural network, but it is the simplest form of AI which you have seen. Okay, I'll give you an example in this way. You want to go from Bhopal to say Delhi, and if you put this, you know, starting point and destination point in GPS, Google GPS, you will see that it is giving you 2-3 options. One option, which is the shortest. Another, which you can design, you can drag that path to whatever you want to. And one path may be by walk, one path may be by train, one path may be by road. So you have so many options. And then you actually see that somehow whatever is suiting to you, whatever is suitable to you, suits to you, suiting is a wrong term, suits to you, is actually going to be opted by you, right? So one moral example which I give to my student always, that do not become option in the life. Do work hard that you must have option to choose. When they do MPhom, I always tell them that do your research work in a so good manner, in a so hardworking manner, in a disciplined manner, that you can get a publication, one or two maybe. Also, you can get more than 60%. I do not rely on those who are toppers. They are the best student. I don't have a thinking like that. This mark sheet of 10th examination, when you were in 10th class and I was in 10th class, we used to take on ego that I became second in the class, I became third in the class. What is the use of 10th or higher secondary mark sheet today? Just as a document of date of birth, you utilize it for many applications. But when we were in 10th, it was a matter of pride that I became second in the class. I lost the control. I did not become topper. Important is, in Indian system, you need more than 60% to apply everywhere. Unfortunately, the department where we have studied before even 2000 or 1998, becoming 60% in Sagar University department was a very difficult task. Getting 60% of marks was very difficult. In my BPhom batch, 69% was the highest percentage of the topper in the class. So importance of education is there. Percentage is just a number which you need to maintain. Maintain for some reasons, for application. I don't say that 40% is also a number. What is the problem with that? No, you got the passing mark, but it is not suitable to hit any job application. So a minimum 70, 65, 70 to 80 is more than enough. So whenever I apply for a position of professor or associate in university, what they need is more than 60% in BPhom, more than 60% in MPhom. Now, why I'm telling all this? That whenever we talk about, you know, the networks or the role of artificial intelligence in healthcare system, the important is that we should have options of what to opt. And that's why I always say my student to make yourself so much knowledgeable with publication with good percentage that you can join for PhD. You can also work in an industry. You can work as a teacher in an academic institute all must be your option. You should be able to crack those. So you have options, right? And then you decide what to join. And there is a one kind of student who did not do research, so he is not able to qualify a good PhD in a good institute. He did not work on studies also, so in interviews also he is getting failed. He is not able to teach also, and he is not suitable for an institute also. And that's how he will have a very limited choice, maybe just of opening a retail shop of medical, which is because of his degree or her degree. So this is what, now whenever an artificial system is there, artificial intelligence technique is there, it gives a suitable option, that which option you can choose, which can lead to what destination. I gave you one example of QBD. Though it is not using neural network, GPS is not using neural network. I'm just giving you an overview, because in 1.5 hour of time, I can't tell you the more detail of neural network. But there is an artificial neural network and there is a convolutional network, neural network. These are two, ANN and CNN, are the basic neural network technologies which are helping healthcare a lot. I'll give you now example. Sorry, I'm not taking much now. So same is the natural language processing, that nowadays you know that you are in Germany and Germans don't like to speak even in English. And when they have said something in German, you can record them and Google will translate it to you. This is nothing but a natural language processor processing. Earlier, it was one of the biggest challenge that you landed in Belarus and you don't know the Polish language and you will never understand what they are saying, even to drink a water. You don't know that in German it is called Mitte. And you know, somehow, so the words, unless you know of a particular language, it was very difficult. But because of AI now, you just type a word in Google and translate it into German, it will give you in German language. In English only. You will read it in English, but it will actually pronounce in German. So this is how AI has helped a lot. In fact, you can capture a photograph now in an AI system of Google they have recently launched, that if something is written that you have to, you know, go from, you know, take left turn to go to Vidisha, and it is written in Hindi, you just capture that photograph and they will translate it into German or into, you know, any language which you wish to. So that kind of helping nature of AI is there. But I see that our students, not only students, even I am also indulged in this trap. So I cannot blame always to the student that we are in the trap of AI. And I always suggest my student, do not post every photograph of your day on the status of WhatsApp. Somebody, because now you are a student, you might not have a very good pocket money. But one day you will become an entrepreneur when you will have lots of money in your account, lots of personal information, which you have already shared 2 years before on some platform, which will be utilized by a hacker and he is going to nail you. So somehow that should be very much careful. Now this is all discussion that machine learning, natural language processing, neural network, that give you an outcome which help us in the screening, diagnosis and treatment of different disorders. And that is very, very important to understand. And that is very much helpful to you whenever we take one or two examples. So I give you this example. This person had a broken backbone and that backbone got broken down in an accident. And when the radiological images came, somehow the broken, when the CT scan came from radiology, that the bone compartments which were broken were designed by a software that these should be the shape of a particular, you know, broken pieces of backbone, and that can be replaced. So this is something helping in diagnosis, helping in deciding the surgery, right? Without opening up the exact, you know, location where the surgery is to be done, it is helping. So how, the one example is the cardiology. This is one more example in which there is a representation of ECG and the software is actually designing the ejection fraction of ECG. This is one part of ECG. I'm not going much into detail, but based on the information feed in that software, it is helping to determine the ejection fraction of ECG. So these are certain example I gave you. Now, because my topic was AI in nanomedicine, not to tell you about general AI, but I wanted to connect you that some of you whom may have, you know, what we call Alexa in the home nowadays. It is an example of artificial intelligence. If you tell Alexa that I have a flight in the morning 8 a.m., it will automatically tell you around 6 a.m. that the flight is scheduled now. Umesh, please wake up. You have to reach the airport in an hour. Something like that, which your wife, your friend, your family members will tell you, that will be told by that Alexa device. This is an example of artificial intelligence. You might know that in your phone also, there is a device who can listen to you. The Google has a mic system that you can actually tell them. There are so many advertisements also nowadays you see on television that you can talk to Google, right? So one example is that you tell the Google by, you know, pressing or tapping on the mic icon of the Google search, and you can tell what you want to search. So one funny example I'll give you, my daughter always, you know, uses YouTube. She is just 4 years old. And whenever she wants to see some cartoon, the way she actually give order to Google is something like that. Please play the cartoons without any advertisement. You see the accuracy she wants from the Google. Now, this is something, a changing scenario of artificial intelligence. And now we are actually going to discuss a 15 and 20 minute of time for AI in nanomedicine. But without giving you the importance of AI, AI is not a software, I'm telling you. AI is not computer, I'm telling you. AI is something which extrapolate the existing information and it has its own view. So if you tell the Google that the name of the Jaipur airport is Raja Bhoj Airport, immediately it may respond, no, the name of the Jaipur airport is Sanganer Airport, something like that. So machine has its own view. And that's why in developing country, you will see that most of the people are who are under depression. They tell the story to the Siri on Apple phones. They talk to Siri. So if you say to the Siri that I'm feeling very bored and depressed, Siri will say to you, should I play a song which you like? And automatically it will start playing. This is something which used to be happen, which used to be supported by our friend, by our family member, by our mother, by our parents. When you feel dull, depressed, your mother, your friend, your father, husband, wife, they used to tell you that don't feel depressed, I'm with you, like that. So slowly the AI is taking up the shape. Because we have a very good social structure in India, we have so many family members, we are blessed with this way of living that they are there to take care. In developed countries, when the children get separated from their parents, the parents remain alone and then they are dependent only on machines. And so is the youth who has separated from their parents and they start talking to machines. Now, so many examples I have discussed. Now, coming to nanomedicine. Now, we know that developing nanoparticle can be a difficult or sometimes can be a simple task. But important is that you should know certain steps to design nanoparticle, but you cannot prepare nanoparticle with all the 100 type of possible combination. So you decide minimum possible steps to design nanoparticle. This is one way of doing it. The other way of doing is that you know that this is the best step. I have nothing to do. This is the only step to follow based on the previous existing knowledge. But now we have systems AI-based systems. One, I gave you example of DOE, that whatever information, minimum information, if you are able to tell them, they can design the possible methods. They can tell you what are the possible ingredients to be utilized. This will be good, this will not be good, this will have a reaction, this will have an incompatibility issue. And that's how it is helping a lot in designing the nanomedicine carriers, in developing the nanomedicine carriers. Now, one example I'll take from this, that we are going to develop certain nanoparticles utilizing certain ingredients whose trade name is SDC, CTS, maybe cholesterol, maybe some surfactant, maybe certain lipids. Forget about these names. You have some ingredients to develop a liposome. Okay. And certain formulations you have prepared. Say, for example, 2-3 formulations you develop. Those who are teachers in this discussion, they might absolutely remember the days when we used to work in the Sutix formulation or any formulation in which we used to optimize. Now, this optimization term has been literally taken up by artificial intelligence. So what was optimization? So all of you remember the Anderson pipette experiment, which you did in physical pharmacy, rate of sedimentation of a suspension. One of the objective my teacher used to give to us, Professor S.K. Jenser, who was my teacher for physical pharmacy. And he used to give us an objective that study the effect of percentage of suspending agent on any kind of suspension, maybe a suspension of any drug. So what my teacher used to give us, that use 2%, 3%, 4% of suspending agent and find out which suspending agent is suitable for developing or preparing the best suitable or best stable suspension. Whenever he used to give this task, of course, we used to prepare 3 formulations. One with 2% suspending agent, the another suspension with 3, another with 4. We used to pour it in the Anderson pipette. I hope you all remember what is Anderson pipette. So we used to stick a graph paper on Anderson pipette. We used to shake it. We used to keep it at a stable, at a flat surface. And we used to observe the rate of sedimentation using the formula R square, something like that. And we used to come up that in which percentage the rate of sedimentation is least, or the rate at which the particles of the suspension are getting settled is the least one, or the lesser one, least one. Why we are looking for the least one? We always say that whenever we shake it, it should resuspend the particles in the suspension. That is a good suspension, should not make a cake, hard cake. Okay, I'm not taking into ideal properties of suspension. A very good question asked for 5 or 10 marks, which I used to write for say 2 pages. Okay, so a good suspension is a suspension which should not settle. It should be able to read, we should be able to redisperse it. Okay, and when the Anderson pipette we used to have, the rate of suspension, somebody is, you know, giving reply in the chat. Thank you so much. I got your answer. And it is absolutely fine that yes, the ideal suspension is, Sarjana has replied that because rate of suspension should be low, it is a good suspension. And by the way, I was talking about the experiment. So we have prepared 3 suspensions just to get an idea of one ingredient, which is suspending agent, that in which optimized quantity, I'm using the term optimized, it should be used. But in the suspension, there are other ingredients also. So we will plan 3 more experiments for another ingredient. For surfactant, for suspending agent maybe, different type of suspending agent maybe. Imagine the number of experiments will increase. So nowadays, and this whole process or this whole exercise which we used to do for our formulation in the M.Pharm thesis or during our M.Pharm, our M.Pharm days for the project, this all was considered as one of the section which will be portrayed in your writings, your manuscripts, in your discussions, and that's how you can improve your English. The other way which I tell to the, because I'm discussing this problem because this is a genuine problem of our B-form and M-form students. They always say that, sir, I have a difficulty in writing in English. And I always tell them to read even the newspaper in English and tell them that read that section of the newspaper only, which you already know. What does it mean? So I have seen an IPL match. I don't see IPL, by the way, but somebody has seen yesterday's IPL match. You know every ball of that match, okay? In the tomorrow's Times of India, on the sports page, the same story will be there. Who made century? Who took the wickets? You know the story. What has happened yesterday? So start reading that column of the news, which you already know. Which you already know. So that you will start correlating the sentence that what has happened yesterday. So when somebody is writing that it was a spectacular batting session by Virat Kohli, you will correlate something related to Virat Kohli because he did a good batting. This is spectacular word or whatever you say, a stormy batting inning played by Virat. This is stormy is something related to big, very good or very, very, very enthusiastic kind of. And that's how you will understand the verbal language. And that's how you will start improving your English. So all in all, we came to AI, understanding of importance of AI in our day-to-day life. Then I took you into healthcare, divided into machine learning, deep learning, the neural network, natural language processing, some sections of these. And then we came to some examples which were very less, but I tried to convey what I wanted to. Then I took the importance in AI nanomedicine, took the example of liposome to make you aware. And that's how we came into the final slide we call conclusions. I'll just read out so that you will actually correlate what we have discussed. The field of nanomedicine is harnessing a collection of versatile carriers to improve the targeting of disease sites and localization of drug delivery. That's what I told you. These carriers have recently served as a gateways towards combinatorial nanotherapy to further increase treatment efficacy by simultaneously addressing multiple disease pathways. I'll tell you a little bit about this. What do you mean by combinatorial or simultaneous delivery, which is my area of core research, which I'm interested to do. Now, so combination therapy is something which you know already. Now, combination means you remember a very classical, I always say, cult disease in our country, tuberculosis. Now, if you see, tuberculosis cannot be treated by a single drug. I wonder why still TB exists in our country. It should be completely eradicated, but it is not the reality. So we take so many combination of drug in tuberculosis. One is, you can say, isoniazid, rifampicin, right? Ethambutol, even erythromycin, right? So rifampicin, isoniazid, ethambutol, pyrazinamide, these are the very, very first line drugs, very important first line drugs used for the treatment of tuberculosis. That is a meaning that this disease cannot be treated by a single drug. It needs a combination treatment, okay? When I say combination, giving combination drug is a very challenging part. But nowadays, nanomedicine, that means you can deliver two drugs using one nanoparticle. That is what I'm telling you, and that is why they're taking momentum. So is the disease cancer, which cannot be treated only by a single drug. If someone is having breast cancer, it cannot be treated only by docetaxel. It needs addition of cisplatin also. It may need a combination of doxorubicin also. So combination is the need of our for the treatment of dreadful diseases like cancer. And utilizing nanomedicine, what ratio of combinations should be used is what supported by AI nowadays. It helps a lot that whether the combination will be synergistic, antagonistic nature, toxic, whatever it is. So it gives you a ready-made information, which really, really help a scientist to develop a formulation. So in addition, patients vary substantially, which also can be feeded as information to get the optimum treatment outcome of based on AI. And AI plays a critical role in reconciling this space into an actionable treatment response. Now, this is very, very important that somehow you need that AI is also gaining the information every now and then. And whenever they get the information, that information is always there to be utilized for the next application. That is a very good importance of data. And this is why you should know that AI is day by day getting empowered. Google को कौन empower करता है? Google ऐसा नहीं है कि उसके पास हर सवाल का जवाब है. आप उसको सवाल देते हैं. सवाल कैसे देते हैं? जब आप कोई सवाल पूछते हैं और उसके रिस्पॉन्स में कोई सर्च का रिजल्ट नहीं आता है, इसका मतलब गूगल की टीम के पास उस सवाल का जवाब है ही नहीं. लेकिन आप देखेंगे, यू विल सी दैट आफ्टर 10 डेज, आपने आज एक सवाल डाला कि आपके गांव में एक मोहल्ला है, उसमें एक तिवारी जी रहते हैं. तो आपने लिख दिया रत्नेश तिवारी जी का घर पांडे मोहल्ले में कहां पर है. ये गूगल रिस्पॉन्ड नहीं कर पाएगा. आप कहेंगे सर बड़ा फनी सा क्वेश्चन है, मतलब ऐसा कैसे गूगल से आप पूछ सकते हैं. पूछने वाले पूछते हैं, राइट? टाटा स्काई वाला आपको क्या बोलता है? पूछने में क्या जाता है, राइट? आपको टाइप करने में क्या जाता है? आप टाइप कर दीजिए क्वेश्चन. ओके, आई एम जस्ट टेकिंग एन एग्जाम्पल. ऐसा मत सोचना कि तिवारी जी का घर ढूंढ के ही दे देगा गूगल आपको 5 दिन बाद. आई एम जस्ट गिविंग यू एन एग्जाम्पल दैट यू हैव टाइप्ड अ क्वेश्चन इन द गूगल विच इट कैनॉट रिस्पॉन्ड. Done. There are so many things. If you go into the physiology, it will not be able to respond certain very deep questions which are only answered when you take a medical education, suppose. But the important part of Google is that after 10 days, there is a team behind that. What are the questions which are not answered by the Google today? They will start searching on the internet through different sources. They will connect the answer of that question with that particular question. Whatever possible answers they can get from the internet, dig out from the data already available. And whenever you will put the question for the next time, maybe after a week, I'm sure you will have some answers. And that's how humne hi hathiyar de diye Google ko ki aapko sab jawab de. And that's how I'm taking this as a funny example. But this is how we make a software empowered, more knowledgeable, more filled with data, right? बिल्कुल वैसे ही जैसे एक बिजनेसमैन शुरू में शॉप शुरू करता है और वो कहता है भैया जितनी डिमांड होगी उस हिसाब से हम मटेरियल रखेंगे. धीरे धीरे जैसे जैसे डिमांड बढ़ती है उसकी शॉप बढ़ती है और एक बहुत बड़ी शॉप में वो कन्वर्ट हो जाता है. दैट्स हाउ वी एम्पावर कस्टमर्स हैव एम्पावर्ड दैट शॉप, राइट? बिकॉज देयर वाज अ नीड ऑफ दैट प्रोडक्ट, ही हैज एम्पावर्ड, ही हैज एक्सटेंडेड हिज बिजनेस और हर बिजनेस. सो एआई इज ऑल्सो गेटिंग एम्पावर्ड डे बाय डे. As the problems comes, as in now the problem comes, it is getting important. So this was all basic about what we have discussed today. There are certain papers which we are actually working on. For example, the first paper I want to tell you is a delivery of 2 drugs together using 1 nanoparticle. Okay, one of the PhD student did that recently. In the second also, we are actually working on 2 drug delivery. So many other recent publications I'm just quoting, which actually relate on, you know, combination drug delivery, which is area of my research, in which we are actually utilizing certain softwares. So this is my small group, and I'm really thankful to all my students first, who really take part in, you know, giving me this opportunity to work in this area. They really contribute a lot. I'm thankful to all my collaborators of different institutes, so that we are able to deliver, you know, some as a part of research. And I'm highly thankful. This is a photograph of my university campus, which is very new. Whenever you visit to this area in Rajasthan, and when you travel from Jaipur to Ajmer, there is a town called Kishangarh. Before Kishangarh, this is a university, which is a central university of Rajasthan. and our campus is some 518 acre of campus. Whenever you visit, please visit us. It will be very nice experience for you. Thank you so much for patience listening and giving me this opportunity to speak in front of you. If you have any questions, I'm ready to answer. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. If any of the participants, if you have any query, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
I'm on time, Surbhi ma'am, right? I did not exceed the time, I think.
No, sir, we are perfectly on time. And aapki session hum sun rahe the, to hume pata hi nahi chala actually time kaise nikal gaya, because I didn't miss even a single slide of your lecture. And thank also you. I have written some points which I, if you permit, so that I can brief your lecture in some points.
Sure.
So from starting, I just want to brief sir lecture. Sir has discussed the topic of the today's lecture is artificial intelligence in nanomedicines. Sir has beautifully explained each and every slide with a practical example. The example which was taken by the sir is very practical, and it is really simple and understandable to everyone. Sir has discussed nanoscience, how nanomedicine is helpful and emerging as a technology, what are the applications of nanomedicine in diagnostic as well as in therapeutic uses. And then artificial intelligence came into picture, that how artificial intelligence is helpful in nanomedicines. And sir took the example of Amazon, Flipkart, first example, second one, Google Map or GPS. And then sir took the topic that is artificial intelligence in healthcare system. The Alexa, sir took the example of Alexa also, that how we instruct them and they will do the things as per our instructions. Sir has discussed about machine learning and deep learning methods, in which he discussed about QBD approach and DOE. And sir has also discussed neural network, in which sir discussed about ANN and CNN. And the beautiful line which was really motivating, which was discussed by sir, is do not work hard to be the option, do work hard to have an option to choose. So that is really very motivating line, sir. Though we are faculties, but we are listening to you like a student. बहुत कुछ सीखने को मिला सर आपके लेक्चर से, एंड इट वॉज रियली वेरी इन्फॉर्मेटिव. एंड एक्चुअली नाउ एट लास्ट वी केम टू नो एट दैट एक्चुअली आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस इज नॉट एनी सॉफ्टवेयर और एनी मशीन, बट इट्स जस्ट एन एक्सट्रापोलेटिंग द एग्जिस्टिंग इन्फॉर्मेशन. सो विद दैट नोट, थैंक यू सो मच सर. एंड नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट द ऑडियंस, इफ दे आर हैविंग एनी डिस्कशन और क्वेरी, सो यू आर वेलकम. प्लीज अनम्यूट योर सेल्फ एंड आस्क योर क्वेरी. Any participant, or you can write in the chat box also. Priyanka ma'am, is there any query came in chat box? Can you please check it one?
Yes. First of all, I would like to say, sir, very informative, and you have delivered such an excellent talk. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing very important information, and your lecture is really. You have delivered an excellent talk. There are two questions I have seen in the chat box. One from Dr. Payal Dande. She wants to ask, how will artificial intelligence going to change the treatment in future?
So I can take this example. I took only one discussion about this, that I think he is asking about how it can help in the treatment. So I give you an example of robotic surgery, which you nowadays see. And robotic surgery is something which is a part of artificial intelligence. Now, based on the regular surgeries, day by day, that robot get an information. And in the next course of time, in fact, in the cities like Indore also, you will see some robotic helps which are being taken in the operation theater as well. So the robotic surgery, I can specifically answer, is one example of AI taking part in the treatment. That is one which is, I'm taking this example because that example you might have seen in the televisions or in documentaries, maybe somewhere. But there are many more which are in the pipeline. I gave you an example of liposome, that developing formulation is also part of treatment, right? Optimum formulation. And there also there is an equal application of AI. So that is what I think I could answer what you asked.
nano robotics also come in that concern only, no?
Yes, yes, definitely.
Coronary artery blockage. Yes.
Yes, yes, that is also. But somehow it is now what Priyanka ma'am has said is absolutely correct. But it started from machine learning. There it comes the very important. So it is only doing the part which is directed by the physician. But if you ask that machine to find out the clot by itself in angioplasty, if you are talking about specifically, or angiography especially, then they itself cannot find out the clot. That is what is actually the new version of AI, which I want to emphasize. So it is shifting from machine learning to neural network, very specific. It is now having its own opinion. That is what it should be understood. So that is what.
Yes, sir. There is another question from Dr. Ram Vishnoi, sir. He yes. want to ask how we can utilize artificial intelligence in therapeutic monitoring and community pharmacy.
Okay, I'll give you one example of this. Now, this is completely software-based systems in which you feed and details of the individuals which are living or medical history of individual who are living in a particular zone. Once you feed this information, then you can get an idea that which kind of diseases are more prevalent in this particular area of population. For example, we historically know Africa is one of the biggest hit countries for malaria. It is one of the most dreadful disease in African countries. How does we know this? This we know because there are many cases which were reported. Now imagine that you have an AI system which is full of the medical history of individuals. And based on the medical history, it is giving an opinion that this area may have this particular disease which must be taken care of, or a person who is shifting to that area should take care of these particular aspects as a part of community pharmacy, so that it will be helpful for his well-being. That is what the AI is doing. Okay, so this is just one hypothetical example I have given to you, but specifically I can't answer because I have not seen any specific example of AI in community pharmacy so far. Maybe I'm not able to fetch it, but yes, I'll keep in mind and maybe I'll try to find out this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, there is.
Nihi Prakash Jain, sir, want to ask something. Sir, please unmute.
Very good afternoon, sir. This is Nishi Prakash Jain. I'm also working in the pharmaceutics department in Sage Group of Pharmacy College. I would like to share the one important hypothetical Hollywood movie that is known as The Fantastic Boys.
Yes.
I think it was launched in 1966.
Yes.
As you told that this concept was came in 1974. I think you have told about this with the one of Japanese person.
Yes.
If you will see this movie, as already you told everybody that one should see the Hollywood movies and all this. So they have hypothesized all these things, including the technology, how they can use the laser beam to destroy antibodies. So this is only sharing only. I think you might have seen this movie.
Yes,
so,
I have seen that.
Okay, you have gone through this movie. So I'm just sharing this thing only because whenever so there is a...
It is absolutely correct, Vikashji. I agree, absolutely agree with you. In 1974, actually, they gave the term nanotechnology, but visualization of nanotechnology was long back. In fact, we all see that movies or imagination is the one of the basis of, you know, newer discoveries nowadays, which we see. So even movies like Star Wars and those which we see nowadays, maybe in future we have some weapons like those which we see in that. So we can't deny that. I am absolutely agree with Vikashji. Thank you for sharing.
No, as far as the medicine are concerned, we are using a lot of bhasmas, which is in nanoparticles only.
Yes.
So it is not new as far as our country are concerned.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for such a lovely, nice presentation. Where you have augmented the nanotechnology with artificial intelligence. That is a very nice combination which you have presented. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
I can see, Priyanka ma'am, more questions. The one asked by Shivendra Kumarji, the lipids-based versus polymer-based nanosystem. So which we can choose, it depends. Like, it depends on physicochemical property of the drug, intended site where you want to deliver. When I say depends, you may say that it is very general answer, sir. But I can tell you that the lipidic carrier obviously will be more suitable for lipophilic drugs, obviously. And polymer can be hydrophilic and lipophilic also. For example, dentamer is a polymer. It is with multiple NH2 groups and it is very suitable for delivering hydrophobic drugs. So if you give a hydrophobic drug to me, I will be more interested to deliver it through dendrimers. But if you will give me a lipid soluble drug, generally hydrophobic is also lipid, can be lipid soluble, obviously. But if it is more lipid mimicking, I'll take the lipid based carriers so that I can get more encapsulation. So it depends on physical chemical property of the drug, polymer, the lipid which you are using. That is the answer which I can deliver at this time. So I hope I could answer, Shivendraji, what you asked.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. And Dr. Ram Bishnoi ji again asked one question, that is nano formulation suitable for protein drug delivery system in oral formulation? It is a very, aap basically ye bolna chah rahe hain ki insulin ki kab tablet banegi. This is something like that, which is one of the biggest hit area of delivering proteins by oral route. Yes, people have attempted.
Yes,
so
sir.
Many research, so many research papers we can see nowadays flooded with this concept of oral delivery of peptide proteins. But a little has been achieved in this route. Still, the most followed or most preferred insulin formulation is the insulin injections only. So this is just an example I have taken. But answer to your question is yes, nano formulation is suitable. There are certain, like silica nanoparticles, if you see, they are gaining momentum in delivering proteins. So it is a very big question. There is no particular answer to that. But yes, there is something which you will see in the research papers, which says that the nanotechnological formulations can be used for protein oral delivery. I took an example of insulin particularly. So yes, there is something.
Thank you, sir. One more question, sir.
Please.
Sir, in drug nano drug delivery system in form of nanoparticle, liposome or any other system, what is the criteria behind the release of these particles? Is that system totally absorbed in the blood, or it release the drug in the intestinal cells or whatever that is the from where we want to deliver?
Okay, so your question is a bit broad, I would say. So if you talk about route of administration, it matters. For example, if nanoparticles are to be given orally, it is believed that as a whole, nanoparticles get absorbed from the interstitial spaces of the small intestine or the microflora of small intestine. They are taken up as a whole in the portal vein. But if you talk about the IV route, they are directly going into the blood. We all know this. But after going into the blood, what happens to the nanoparticle in general? What is the fate of nanoparticle, basically, you are asking in terms of...
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So there comes the role of sustained and controlled release nanoparticles or nanoformulations. If you have designed the nanoparticles to sustain the release, obviously, the slow release will be there. In some instances, that the nanoparticle as a whole will go directly into the cells. I gave you an example of tumor physiology, in which you could see that nanoparticle from the leaky vasculature directly entered into the tumorous cell, and obviously there it will release the drug. So again, the answer of your question will be depends on route of administration, that is one. Depends on fabrication for which you have designed the nanoparticle, whether it will be in sustained form, controlled form, targeted form. So release can be modulated, can be controlled or designed according to where and when you want to have the release of that particular drug from the nanoparticle. So that we can test in vitro when we do it, in vitro release at different pH, at different buffers, maybe in the simulated gastric fluid, you know, simulated intestinal fluid, you know. So we actually check it in vitro level to get the in vitro in vivo correlation to predict how its release will be there in the in vivo system, or whenever it will be in the in vivo phase, how it will release. I hope I could, you know, answer what you asked a little bit.
There is one more. Yes, sir. We can maintain the pH of blood during the release system or not?
No, maintaining blood pH is not in our hand. pH of the blood will remain as per the homeostasis of our body, right?
So then how we will, we should decide that our whole system get, if I think that whole system get absorbed in the blood, then how from the system the drug get escaped? How I decide, sir?
First of all, the blood doesn't absorb the drug. Blood can only bind the drug with the proteins, maybe albumin and all those, or either the drug will remain free in the blood. Whenever it will be having thin layer of endothelium, the drug will actually get absorbed in the different tissues. So pH will always remain constant, that is around 7.4, we say physiological pH, okay, of the blood, starting from 6.9 to 7.4. So pH is not going to vary much. But the area where drug absorption will take place depends on the carrier as well as the physiological or, you know, physicochemical property of the drug. And this decides its absorption.
So there are sometimes some diseases make a very huge difference in the pH at that particular tissue where the we get diseased.
Yes. For example, in cancer, the cancerous cells have acidic pH. So that is why we study the release in a pH-dependent manner. So we decide that it is getting released at acidic pH. It is good for us in cancer. So you are absolutely correct that some diseases have a different pH nature. But that is with the tissue, not with the blood. That is what I want to tell you. Blood is a fluid. You are talking about an organ.
Okay, sir. Okay. I understand it. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I hope I could answer all the queries. Okay. So thank you so much then. Should I end the session, Priyanka?
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
Thank you so much once again, sir. I want to share one thing, sir.
Okay.
Of appreciation from our group.
Sir, kindly accept this token of appreciation on the behalf of entire Sage Group and SIRT Pharmacy, sir, for your valuable time and efforts you took to share your thoughts with all of us. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you once again.
Sir, there is another question from Dr. Abhishek.
Yes.
Actually, he's asking
what are the advancements in the treatment of viral infections related to AI-linked nanomedicine? I don't have much information of a particular disease in understanding AI, but one example of not the treatment, I would say, but in the diagnosis or in the awareness was like something which government has designed, app you might know, Arogya Setu and all. They were, you know, not AI based, but somehow they were close to AI, you know, based systems which are helping in fighting with this situation on. But particularly, I have no information, frankly. I'll look into this, which you have asked. I'll try my best to look into some viral-based or viral disease-based, you know, AI system advancement for treating viral infection. So I don't have much information, Abhishek ji, at this point. So I think all the questions.
Yes, sir. You have resolved all the queries of our participants. And thank you so much, sir, for your such a wonderful and informative session. Very nice for me to hear you after a long time.
Thank you
so much, sir. And personally, we want to that offline we have sir, आपका presentation यहाँ college बुलवाकर करवा सके sir. Whenever the conditions become normal, sir.
Thank you, Surbhi ji. Thank you, Priyanka ji, and convey my regards to Suren sir also. And thank you once again for inviting me, giving me this opportunity to talk to all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
Stay healthy.
Have a great day, sir.
So there is a small announcement.
I think all the participants have filled the feedback link. And if anyone has... So after 2 minutes, you can end the meeting.
Yes, ma'am. And the schedule for tomorrow,
I hope
A4 will be shared on the WhatsApp group.
Okay, so thank you all the participants. Have a great day.